Hey, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all of the other episodes, check the link in the description, stop by raprankings.com, or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform. And please consider liking, subscribing, and commenting to help us grow the channel and continue our journey as hip-hop's first and premier extreme podcast. Track 6, Chum, produced by Random Black Dude and Christian Rich. All right. Brother, 8 minus.
Moulz Mel connect, 8 minus.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow. Well, I don't know about you, but it's my favorite song on the album, so.
I'm going to take it a step further. This is my favorite. Nah, this is the best Earl Sweatshirt song.
Look at this shit. Look at this shit here, man. Okay? This Chum.
Now, look. I got some archival for this. I got much to say. I'm sure you do as well. Let's talk about the beat first and foremost. Because to me, okay, the captain, Moulz, it's giving equal parts Neptune's influence on not only Earl and Odd Future, but Christian Rich as well. But also that Doom influence. You know, they always compared Earl to Doom. And you get that especially as the beat kind of transforms and rides out at the end. When this shit dropped, I remember this being a beat where I recall thinking, like, the Doom comparisons and influence Earl spoke of made a little more sense. And that this was a beat that, like, I would have loved to have heard Doom on. And that said, as much as I would have loved to hear Doom on this beat, I wouldn't have wanted to hear Doom on this song, because this is a great career-defining performance from Earl.
Yeah,
as he checks off the ultimate box for that debut album. Who are you? What's your deal? You know, he gets into it. A pretty brave first single, might I add. That feels like it's like a great album cut, but it's a single, you know? Perfect verse alert on verse one.
Agreed!
Perfect.
Oh my god!
Perfect verse alert. I don't know if I'll ever give this guy perfect verse alert ever again, but this is like the verse of the life for this guy. Like, this is... The boy has become a man.
Yes. Yes. And okay. I'll add something, because you said, like, in terms of, like, being... You know, that first album song and representative of like who he is and what he has to offer. I feel like this is a song, though, that makes good on the hype. Like, if this was the first Earl song I had ever heard, it wasn't. But like, I would have been like, oh, OK, I see what this kid's deal is. Like, yeah, he's got a style and he can fucking rap, you know? And
not only that, dude, verse one, perfect verse alert, right? But he's doing the heavy internal rhymes that we were kind of just criticizing on the last record, but they aren't just random words that sound good strung together. He's telling us his story. It's working in service of the record. Yes. He's rapping really well, but he's still getting his point across.
That was my first note. I said it's peak syllable bullshit, but this is a compliment. Because this is like, this is as good as it gets with that. When he's in that, you know... It's probably been 12 years since my father left and left me fatherless. And I just used to say I hate him in dishonest jest. You know, like 16, I'm hollow and tolerant, skip shots, I'll storm that whole bottle. I'll show you a role model. I'm drunk, pissy, pissing on somebody front lawn, trying to figure out how and when the fuck I miss moderate. It's all connecting
and
to
then
the narrative.
How he goes from moderate to mama often was offering
peace offering, stink weeds, cough, scoffing, and he's off again. You know, like, but it's all
and
part
then
of the
pulling
story.
Pulling back again, searching for a big brother. Tyler was that. Like, okay, we're easing up.
Right.
Slow down, work a hold.
Plus, he like how I rap. The one that mice in the trap. But, like, again, it's also working it. And you know, you love this. I love this. It's that anecdotal. It's that he's recollecting.
Yep.
I'm in my fucking bag on this verse. Like, I'm loving it. You know? It's emo. It's diary raps. It's rapping, technically. You know? And I just, yeah, perfect verse alert. Even the, like, I can even excuse the, like, this has become a trope, like, too black for the white kids, too white for the blacks. But, hey, he's describing a point in time, you know, when we, like, you know, as a teenager, as a kid, you have that, like, undeveloped outlook or, you know, on whatever, you know, serious topic in the world. Like, that reductiveness works because it was a point in time, you know? It might be embarrassing now, like, that we all seem to have this higher consciousness about racial politics, but it works here, you know? There are moments growing up as a kid where you feel like that, you know?
I'm indecisive, I'm scatterbrained, I'm frightened. It's evident in them eyes where he's hiding all the micicles at. Like, the whole verse from top to bottom, perfect verse alert.
Yes, yes. You know, this is fucking ear candy for me. And I mean, that beat, it's dirty,
and I dig
filthy,
the chorus as a rap song. Chorus is something sinister to it. Pendulum swinging slow, degenerate
moving through the city with criminal stealth. Welcome to enemy turf, heart of the immigrants, work off the stitch of my shirt. And I've loved this line since the year that this was dropped as a single with the video. Get up off the pavement, brush the dirt up off my psyche. It's like one of those, I love it. It's one of those things I wish I wrote. I love it so much.
I love it with the little, the trailing off ad libs.
Psyche. Yes, man. Okay.
And I'm going to say
this. Like, my favorite Earl song too. I mean.
Verse two is good. It's just not perfect. Verse alert. It's not as good as verse one. But right. he drops some shit in that verse two. You know, time lapse, bars rotten, harps bottomless pit. Was mobbing deep as 96 Havoc and Prodigy did. You know, he's doing his, you know, like, just a nod of recognition and respect. You know, this is what you expect from, like, what they're saying about him, right? Like, mm-hmm. Oh, he's about to be, like, one of the next greats. And, you know, but again, we're not going to shift away from the point of the record. So we're already immediately after we get that, like, hard opening bar and we get that nod to the greats, we're right back into the anecdotal bars. We were the potty mouth posse, crash a party and dip with all belongings and toss them out to the audience.
Yeah.
Nothing was fucking awesome trying to make it from the bottom. They're describing
as hard as Vince Carter, you know, Carter,
describing
which is a fucking bar,
our future and everything, you know?
Yeah. But we get, all right. We get the centerpiece of the album, if you ask me. And bro,
oh yeah, listen, with Keith Particles entering apartments with Zine article
tolerance for boundaries.
I know you happy now. Craving in these complex fuck redacteds.
Track me down. Just to be the guys that did it. Like, I like attention.
I like attention.
You know,
and that's not how he's rapping on the last mixtape at all. This is a elevated level of technique that he displayed from the previous mixtape with just the word salad, internal rhyme schemes and whatnot. That's like rapping 101. He's advanced to rapping 102 at a lot of different points on this album, not in every song, but on many different points throughout the album.
I agree. I just appreciate that this is that moment of reckoning for all of the hype and expectations that were hoisted upon him. Foisted?
Not the type where redacted is trying to get a raise at my expense, supposed to be grateful, right? Like, thanks so much.
You made my life harder.
The ties between my mom and I are strained and tight. Like, man, if you know at all about the actual, you know, lore, quote unquote, and the drama of all of that situation, which eventually led to Earl and his mom reconciling and having a very strong relationship with one another. But, you know, like, that shit makes me sad, man, to hear in the verse. Like, because it's always going to come back to the fact that, like, you know, we joke around, like, obviously we're not really, like, calling Jesse a groomer or anything like that. But, like, there were some really clout hungry people around the time, thirsty to ultimately derail the life of a minor so that he could do rap songs for them.
which is insane. He had, look, this is the moment where he talked to these fuck nigga cokehead, yo, redacted ass journalists. Like, I love it. That's right. Fucking love it.
So
he's fighting back against the groomers. It's not, okay?
It's not no perfect verse alert, but it's a verse that's needed in the song to continue to kind of drive home that this is the record where he has truly arrived and made his statement. And I think, you know, that's kind of why it became the single, because there's so much of that baked into it that, you know, people need to hear before you hear anything else from this album. This is a kid who had to grow up fast, already looking back as if his career is like over when he's not even old enough to drink alcohol yet. It's when fucking sad.
The verse. Yeah. I mean, it's, keep in mind, it's like the first single. And this is what makes it even more explosive, you know? Ties between my mom and I are strained and tightened even more than they were before all of this shit. Been back a week and I already feel like calling it quits. Like, I love that shit. That's the type of shit I would do on the first single. In fact, I don't even know, maybe subconsciously on like my, like one of the Pizza Boy albums, the first track, I was like, I'm kickstarting my career with a mic drop. I don't know. Maybe subconsciously I was, had this in mind. I don't know. I'll give him his credit, but this is Earl at his best to me. Like, I live to hear situations, like, encapsulated perfectly. Like, no wasted bars. When you get your point across in such an exact way, I love it. I admire it. It's why I got into this shit as a rapper.
If every Earl song had a beat this good and had raps that were this...
He'd be one of my favorite rappers, bro.
Raw and emotive. He'd be my favorite rapper of this generation.
You know,
it's just that I never got one of these again. I got moments on certain songs that I can feel like a little bit of that pull, but this is everything. This is the beat. This is the rhymes. This is the hook. This is the importance of the record and what it meant and the statement that he was trying to make with it. It's a record that, you know, to me, is one of the most raw first singles to ever be released. I got a lot of archival. Well, not a lot compared to some of the other songs in here, but a little bit of archival. Do you want to hear the sample?
Yeah, I just had one more part or one more point to make about this verse, because this is like when you talk about the way he was hyped up in terms of being beyond his years in terms of ability as a rapper. This is like that little technical flourish that lets me know, like, yeah, this nigga really gives a fuck. Because when he says, supposed to be grateful, right? Like, thanks so much. You made my life, and there's a pause, made my life harder. And the ties between my mom and I are strained and tightened. Because it's a continuation, but it bleeds. It's sort of a double line. Like, thanks so much. You made my life. But it continues. You made my life harder. You know?
Yeah.
And it's like those little details that I love as a rap nerd. It's like, yeah, I'm going to tell you this too, because I just remember this. I think I bought this song when it dropped as a single. You can never actually call me an Earl hater or iFuture or anything. I always give him the credit when it's due. I bought this song.
This song stayed in rotation much longer than this album did for me, I'll say.
Yes. Yes. So I like it a lot. Always have. But yeah, we got archival here. So
we do. We have the sample, which is the Vibrettes Humpty Dump.
Oh, okay.
And we got some examples of the sample being used prior to this as well.
Well, this is the Vibrettes with Humpty Dump. Drum break in there?
Yes, exactly.
Got it.
There's a little more than the drum break on Digital Underground's The Humpty Dance, though. Oh, if you want to play that,
classic! Yeah.
Which also owes a debt to the vibrettes here. So let's hear it. Let's hear about a minute and a half of it, if you don't mind.
What you're doing, cause I'm about to ruin the image and the style that you're used to. I look funny, but yo, I'm making money, see? So yo, world, I hope you're ready for me. Now gather round, I'm the new fool in town, and my sound's laid down by the underground. I drink a bottle of Hennessy you got on your shelf, so just let me introduce myself. My name is Humpty, pronounced with the umpty. Yo, ladies, oh, how I like to funk thee. And all the rappers in the top 10, please allow me to bump thee. I'm stepping tall, y'all, and just like Humpty Dumpty, you're gonna fall when the stereos pump me. I like to rhyme, I like my beats funky, I'm spunky. I like my oatmeal lumpy, I'm sick with this. Straight gangster Mac, but sometimes I get ridiculous. I'll eat up all your crackers and your licorice. Oh, yo, fat girl, come here, are you ticklish? Yeah, I called you fat. Look at me, I'm skinny. It never stopped me from getting busy. I'm a freak. I like the girls with the boom. I once got busy in a Burger King bathroom. I'm crazy. Allow me to amaze thee. They say I'm ugly, but it just don't faze me. I'm still getting in the girls' pants, and I even got my own dance.
The Humpty Dance is your chance to do it all.
Come on.
All right, Mel, there's more archival, but I have to take a quick pit stop real quick. I emailed it to you. I may have just had a revelation.
Okay.
I think Sha kind of raps like Shock G. You know, Sha of Sha is Coming fame?
Yeah. Okay, well, you sent me... the artwork on this is money! All right, this is Sha James with Are You Ready? Well, let's see if your realization is nonsense or not.
Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for me? Written in the stone, Sha's gotta go, no. Yeah, I'm ready for this, now I'm ready like MC. My tank is on full, you're on a bike cause you're on MT. Shout out to plenty of MTs that was meant to be, but found out she was just a freak. Y'all not ready for me to blow. God gave me the gift of song, so I got to let it go. Y'all not ready for an artist so sincere. I'm releasing the beat to fill up on listeners and shit. Your ears are gonna feel a little queer. One shot James gets up in there. Like Tenacious D, the people are making me just pull out my dick and come in your ear, pussy. 'Twas written in the stone, I've gotta go now. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for me? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for me?
We are ready for you, Sha, whenever you decide to come. But I can kind of see what you're getting at. It's no more crazy than my backseat of my dad's car realization in like 2011 that Will Smith raps like Charles Hamilton. Or dude, rather, the Will other way around.
Sha, I was about to say, dude, Sha patterns his rapping. I don't know if he patterns his rapping after Shock G. I don't think he listens to Digital Underground. He patterns his rapping after Biggie and Will Smith.
Is that right? Okay. Look, you know how I feel about Big Will. That's my dog. Yeah. But can't wait to review
it's
him
crazy again. To have, like, that's your, those are your two biggest influences, though.
I mean, hey, like, you know, I mean, I don't have to go through it. If you know rap, you know rap. But I mean, Fresh Prince was one of them niggas. All right, he was in here. He was in the dough early, you know, like, all right. So
I'd say there's a little J in there. But I mean, you know, it's big, really, because we know about J.
Yeah, we do. Well, what else do we have in terms
we
of
we have Q-Tip. Let's ride. Off of Amplified, and okay. It's another one that uses a drum break.
All right, let me see. Let's
Dilla beats.
Yeah, Dilla beats. But did you include this song,
Q-Tip? Let's ride.
I don't see it in the folder.
You don't see Q-Tip? Let's ride.
I don't see it.
From Amplified.
No, I don't see it. Did you put it in a different folder? What's that?
I don't know. Maybe I put it in a different phone. Dealer got it.
The dealer?
mean,
he's on deck at all times, you know. It's why he's a good dealer. You know, he comes in the middle of the night and drop off the product. Okay, let me hit him up. I'm texting him now. If he's got this Q-tip amplifier, let's ride. He says he's got it. He's on the way. So
nice.
Yeah.
He rarely fails us.
I don't think he's ever failed us. At least since we started acknowledging him as our plug on the air. As the dealer long-time rap rankings listeners, call in. 718-635-0743. Has the song dealer ever failed us on air, live? Like, you know, he texted us back, nah, I ain't got it, you know? Oh, he just dropped it off. He sent me the picture at the front door. The no-contact delivery, you know? All right, here we go. This is Q-Tip Let's Ride from his solo debut, correct? Amplified?
Solo debut. Yep.
To all the low riders, the big riders. No doubt. What happened in the car, yo? For real, many niggas. Brand new truck, butter sauce seat. 4 point something with a low ride something. Ain't nothing better than a ride out the hood with it. Who looking better and damn you looking good in it. Take a chance with a nigga in the choice ride. Listen to the CDs I play inside. Moulz Mel, J, Princess TV, Marvin Gaye, Led Zeppelin, and Biggie. And when the evening is over.
So those drums, right?
Yep.
Did he say he played J Prince in the ride?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm assuming a different J Prince. The boogeyman nigga. Or maybe the boogeyman nigga told him to say that he was listening to him. Yeah, who knows? Anyway, my final note about this song, unless we have more archival, do we?
We do. Isaiah Rashad, Silk Dashaka.
Oh, that guy. I like that guy. Well, the songs of his that I've bothered to listen to, I think I like. Have I heard... Yeah, no, I've heard, what is it, Clitoris Demo, or, you know? Whatever.
Sylvia Demo.
Yeah. I never heard that one, but I heard the other one, the new one.
How do you not hear a Sylvia Demo? That's the good
because
one.
Because you know how it goes. Too many people talking about it. I was like, I'll get to it when I get to it. Y'all
so many people
about
are talking about Clivia. It. This is the bad one.
Clivia Demo. All right, Clivia. Why are you talking Demo? Call me when he releases a finished product, you know?
That is Clivia. The finished product.
Yeah, I get it, right? That's the gimmick. It's Untitled on... Yeah, from the camp that brought you Untitled Unmastered. Finish y'all albums, okay? This is Isaiah
from the show. From the camp that brought you Scissor Control when it should have been Scissor Control Alt Delete.
All right, this is Silk Dashaka, not the artist. It's a song title.
I almost got this one. You got to memorize it. It's for the haves and the have wanna give a fucks. Hey, I ride around in your car. I put my weed in your blunt. I am the sky to your star. I am the end of your month. You are the start of my day. You bought the smile from my face. I see the world from your eyes. You pull the thorn from my side. I know
you- there you go, folks. Hey, come on. We didn't even hear the whole song. You snoring like that. Oh, brother. Moulz, wake up. All right.
What happened? What is it? What happened? Is the movie over yet?
No. We're almost halfway through it. Kind of.
Oh, shit. Did the bomb go off yet?
I'm not going to get sidetracked on this, but yeah, listen, y'all doing this double feature gimmick with Barbie and Oppenheimer. Come on, be smart, okay? That doesn't seem like the most... responsible way to consume those films. Like, they don't go together. Just because they released on the same day and you think it's a meme to watch these tonally different, opposite end of the spectrum films, you're going to find out, I believe, that that wasn't a good idea. Why are you watching
if you really want to see these movies and you're not just being an idiot who's going along with whatever the thing is of the day, go to one on one day and then go to another on another
day. That's all I'm saying. Do you actually honestly
on different days.
Want to watch Please. This movie based on this branded children's doll that's all bright and pink and you know, and then go and watch this like film about the history of human cruelty. Like, is that really actually why you want to spend your day? Keep in mind, one of these movies is 3 hours. The other is like 2. You're going to sit there in the theater.
Let me tell you guys what you want to do. You want to do one of 2 things. You want to see Tom Cruise in Mission Impossible.
Tom Cruise.
Look, he needs money. Not as much money as some of these other people like Indiana Jones need, but we don't want to see Indiana Jones. Tom Cruise seems like he's going to do $17 million less than Oppenheimer, and that just seems cruel. Go see Mission Impossible, or go see Cobweb, you know? The Barbie and Oppenheimer came out on the same day as Cobweb. Don't you feel bad for Cobweb? Don't be a scab and see Barbie and Oppenheimer. See Cobweb, all right? And be an ally.
Yeah, let me see something.
You going to see Cobweb?
I'm not going to see anything. This has been discussed before. I don't have time or money to
throw on the Cobweb trailer. Let's get a live reaction to Mel seeing the Cobweb trailer and weighing in on if he wants to see it or not.
Is this thing even in theaters?
It's out right now. It came out the same day as Barbenheimer, okay?
I don't see. I'm on my local theater. I'm looking at all the movies that are currently available. I don't see this.
Well, I mean, you got to look up the trailer, my dude. Cobweb. Right. It's a white lady. I mean, listen, there's all sorts of races in different movies right now.
Oh shit, this one looks kind of scary. Okay, well, here, this is
Moulz live Day trailer reaction.
God damn it! There's a boy who got.
Oh. It's okay. It was just a bad dream. I heard it again.
No more nightmares tonight. Okay, champ?
Daddy!
This is getting ridiculous.
This is an old house. There's bound to be bumps in the night.
Hold on. Pause. It says from the producer of Barbarian.
From Barbie, bro.
Interesting. Oh, not Barbie. Barbarian. All right, resume.
Peter drew this.
Yes. Is he all right?
Peter has an overactive imagination.
Oh, and it.
No more nightmares.
Now, chapter 1 or chapter 2? Because if it's chapter 1,
that's the real question of the day right now.
No more.
That's right.
I wish I had someone I could talk to about the things that were happening in my house.
Mom? Mom?
Peter, sometimes you have to make hard decisions. Protect your family.
Oh, hold on. This is that, I've never watched the series. Ain't this that Homelander man? Ain't that him?
That's Homelander?
From the Boys? Yeah, I think it's the Homelander man. Right, anyway.
What is that? The banging.
You don't hear anything, Peter.
It's going to get you into trouble one day.
Okay, I've got a rating on this trailer. I'm gonna go flat 7.
Wow.
Looks good. I mean, we got the child drawing, traumatic drawings trope.
I don't love the child aspect, but what's the running time on this cinematic hallucination?
No, I don't think Charles Hamilton executive produced this, but Cobweb is, show me the fucking duration, Google. Didn't they used to put this in the side?
They always put it.
No, they ain't got it. It's just release date.
Type in Cobweb running time.
Yeah, hold on. I got it. I am Debo. Okay. I am Debo. The Rab TV series starring, we're bringing back Tiny Lester. We're going to perform a seance, and it's a series about him. I am Debo and all his adventures. All right. I'm on the IMDb, and it says that it is. Where's the fucking information? Tell me, I'm going to just type it like you said. This is ridiculous. Running time. 1 hour, 28 minutes. There you go.
1 hour.
A normal movie.
28 minutes. Wow, it's less than an hour and a half. Barbie, yeah. 2 hours on the dot. Oppenheimer, 3 hours on the dot. Okay?
You know.
Cobweb. Cobweb.
All right, relax. Cobweb. All right, you got one of them checks lying around from the last song review from Lionsgate. Okay. I guess you cashed that one already.
I thought it was, you know, we're in different industries.
I got it. Okay. Well, the trailer looked good. Shorty's in there was looking attractive. We, you know, it's looking good. They had some things that Mel's.
What was that knocking? That knocking was creeping me out more than anything. Knock.
Was that, what was that? That was that sample from this track. It was that damn Humpty Dump, you know? The Humpty Dump drums were haunting the house.
I want you to show up at your next Barbenheimer showing and let people know when the film starts rolling, we want cobwebs.
I'm not getting
beat up. We want cobwebs.
I'm not getting beat up by no white people. I would stand outside of the theater and like promo for Cobweb over the other two. Like hold a sign. What about Cobweb? You know?
Exactly. What about it? Okay. I fucking feel so bad for this movie. I feel as bad for Cobweb as I do for Earl in these verses.
One kid had a rocky adolescence. Another film is actually successful enough to have made it into theaters and be funded. It's just dropping on the same drop date as two bigger films. I think the film will be fine ultimately.
It's like, you know what?
Earl was fine. I mean, it's.
I want to know something. Now that we're on the subject, what were the other rap albums to come out in 9/11/2007?
Oh, brother, not that day. Okay.
I'm going to get the day right now. Here we go. 9/11/2007. We had 50 Cent and Kanye West, obviously. We also had Grayskull, Bloody Radio, released on Rhymesayers Entertainment. We had Necro with Death Rap, which was on Psychological Records and Koch Records. And then we had Young Noble and Hussein Fatal with Thug In, Thug Out. Those are the cobwebs of 9/11/2007.
Yeah, they sat on the shelf and developed cobwebs, for sure. Listen, people, the moral here is see anything but Sound of Freedom, okay? Don't nobody need to be watching that shit, okay?
Don't see Sound of Freedom because Mel is planning on going to as many showings as he can and he doesn't want to be spotted there.
Bullshit. Okay. Seeing that. Yeah. That's for the people who, when we talk about Earl being, you know, groomed by the groomers, you know, their ears perk up. And they're like, huh? Groomer? Trans people? No. You transphobic fuck. Go watch your Sound of Freedom. Okay. Matter of fact, we don't want to see you in public. So just wait till it comes to that, you know, video on demand. All right. Listen, I'm not even trying to get political, but just purely cinematically speaking, it looks like one of these fake movies.
I'm
like all
you,
of it. Like it looks like straight to DVD.
If like the far right QAnon crowd wants to really make an impact in film, then the good directors that already exist are going to have to go that route on their own. You're not going to find these like it's a watch. There's not one good film of this ilk that exists.
Sound of freedom. What the
fuck? But don't worry, Mercedes Varnato is going to be in an upcoming QAnon film that looks great. Okay,
Let's not do this.
Couldn't even spell her fucking name right on the poster.
Is there anything else to play concerning, regarding, associated with Hive? Or, sorry, Chum?
No.
We're Earl Hive, as of Chum. That's why I made that mistake, okay?
I see. I'm not Earl Hive yet, because I don't have my 10 songs.
I was just trying Earl's to cover my mistake, that's all.
I'm Earl's Chum.
Okay, my final note, this little musical breakdown is at the end of the song that that was also in the trailer. Yeah, like the outro stinger style, you know? Apparently that was Chad Hugo on that part that was playing like the,
you know, our main man.
Our main man, Chad Hugo. But go watch the, I'm sure it's still on YouTube. Watch the album trailer for Doris and like, it's like Earl, he's like glitching out to like the drums. It's very amusing to me. But anyway, would you like to move on?
Yeah, after this quick message, what did Greta Gerwig pull off listening to after she popped up at the Alamo Draft House following a screening of Barbie, even though that's technically considered scabbing?
This is an elaborate joke. What did she listen to?
And I'm scabbing. Yeah. Young Scabby, I'm scabbing. Count 100s on the table, 20s on the flow.
Oh my god.
Greta Hogan, right, are we pulling off?
Are we moving on?
I'm scabbing, dude. All right, this Barbie movie means more than this strike, dude. Brother, nothing's stopping Big Barbie, dude. 150 million first week, brother.
Look, if these brothers don't want to take the contract, dude, I'll take it. Yeah, they don't know how to build heat. What can I say?
Yeah. I'm scabbing. Yeah. Anyway.
Yeah, are we moving on?
Fuck them.
Hey, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all of the other episodes, check the link in the description, stop by raprankings.com, or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform. And please consider liking, subscribing, and commenting to help us grow the channel and continue our journey as hip-hop's first and premier extreme podcast.